Thought it was good. Now I'm good. Yep.
Hello and welcome to the Zell Visiting Writer Series. I'm Michaela Coasters and I am your host for this year. Authors from the University of Michigan each year to meet with our students and give public readings, craft talks, and Q&As. And the series is generously funded by Helen Zell and Janie Lack. And we are very excited to be welcoming Douglas Kearney here with us this evening. As a few administrative announcements before we get started, please note that this event is recorded and posted on the Zell Visiting Writer Series YouTube channel, where you can rewatch or share with a friend later on. If you are joining us on Zoom, closed captioning is enabled, and you can turn that on or off by pressing the CC icon at the bottom right of your screen. And we will also post a copy of Douglas's reading in the Zoom chat shortly. And then as for the structure of tonight's event, in just a minute, MFA student Io Faloma will introduce Douglas Kearney. After that, Douglas will give a reading for about 20 minutes. Around 6 p.m., another MFA student, Chris Crowder, will have a 30-minute conversation with Douglas. And then for the last 30 minutes, we'll open it up to audience questions. So if you're here in person, you can line up on either side of the stage at the mic to ask a question, or if you would prefer to have the mic walked to you, you can just wave and Kevin, our tech assistant, will be standing off to this side and can walk the mic to you. And if you're on Zoom, then you can submit your questions through the chat and our Zoom host, Jen Galveo, will read them aloud on your behalf. And that's all I have. So I will hand it over to Io for an introduction.
Good evening, everybody. Since I know Douglas Kearney's reading is going to be non-traditional, I decided to do a little bit of a non-traditional introduction as well. And it requires a bit of audience participation. And what I want you to do is just scream numbers at me from 1 to 4. Three. Here's a joke from a recent essay by Kearney in Yale Review titled, I Killed, I Died, Banter, Self-Destruction in a Poetry Reading. What do you call it when people who can probably read come to an event to attend other people reading what they've often already read? In the same essay, he writes, it is good for us to be assembled together, and to gather for poetry is even better. We'll get cultured, educated, incited to be something more than what we were. To attend the poet, however, refocuses their attention on something else. Two. It's a bit impossible, at least it seems so, and possibly even ridiculous what I'm trying to do here this evening. I almost said what I've been tasked to do, though I chose to do this. And yes, I did precisely because it seems an impossible thing to do. Ordinarily, my task is simple: introduce the visiting writer. But here lies the conundrum. How do you properly introduce someone who speaks so eloquently about his own work and whose work speaks for itself, especially when it refuses speech? Four. According to J.L. Austin, the British philosopher responsible for what we've come to understand about the theory of speech acts, each utterance we make is not merely a vehicle for passing across information or meaning making. Speech acts too. That is, words do shit. And Douglas Kearney be doing shit with words. With each poem, essay, libretto, Kearney be trying to get us to look over and over at the shit we always trying to overlook. The recurrence of tear away, torn away, tear it away in Dogged, a poem from Shaw, brings to mind Fred Moten's The Salve Trade, in which he writes, If you ain't gonna get down, then what you come here for? What they bring your ass up in here for if you ain't gonna tear shit up? Kearney's is a post-postmodernist project, which is a way of saying it reminds us constantly that if you look and listen closely, and none knew about this shit, it all comes back around, and it seems to me at least that Kearney's trying to finish what Eliot never got around to starting. One, Douglas Kearney has published 7 books, which include Someone Took Their Tongues, a collection of libretti, which M. Nobresi Philip calls a seismic polyphonic mashup that disturbs the tongue, and Mess and Kearney's collection of writing on poetics, and most recently Show, which was published by Wave Books earlier this year, and is currently a finalist for the 2021 National Book Awards. Additionally, Fodder was published by Phonograph Editions this year, and he has multiple operas staged. His work is widely anthologized and published. His work has also been exhibited in museums. He has received a Whiting Writers Award, a Foundation for Contemporary Arts Cy Twombly Award for Poetry, and residencies and fellowships from Kavikanum, the Rauschenberg Foundation, and others. Kearney teaches creative writing at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities and lives in St. Paul with his family. Here's a number you didn't ask for. 5. Violence, spectacle, performance. The 3 most prevalent themes across Kearney's oeuvre. Show, Kearney's most recent collection begins thus. Seen someone, somebody bodied into street sweetmeat, and ends with a boy, the speaker's son, sleeping, quote, under blades, fans spinning back to where it started, and back to where, and back to end. The it being the problem, capital and ontological, which the speaker has been asked to speak about. We start with seems, which by definition means to appear to be, feel, do, etc. And we end with and, a conjunction that in this case seems to be anticipating what word, phrase, clause, sentence might come next. I cannot possibly anticipate what will happen after I leave this stage, but I am ready, and I hope you are too. Ready or not, here it comes. Douglas Kearney, everybody.
Got it. That better?
Yes.
Thank you. It was intimate, y'all. It's just for us here. The deluxe treatment. There's even hierarchies here. I want to thank the Zell Visiting Writer Series. I want to thank Michaela for shepherding me all around and getting me here from over there. Thank you, Io, again. And thank Chris for our conversation soon come. But it's been a great day talking with members of your community. The first thing I'm going to read is the title poem from the book Show. And what I is a form that was invented by a former student of mine named Indigo Weller. And it uses some of the conventions of the sestina, you know, that obnoxious ass poetry form. That for a little while, every MFA program was like, I know how to really piss off our students. let's make them write sestinas. And the overachievers would be like, I've already written a double sestina that loops like you know, like there's that kind of stuff. But this uses, it's kind of like the recurring, repeated end words, the telutons of the sestina. So this poem is called Show. Some need somebody or more to ape sweat on some sight. Bloody pearl or dirty spit, hucked up for to show who gets eaten. Rig body up, bow, bow to breeze a lazed jig and sway to Grig's good fiddling. Pine deep dusk, a spot where stood body. Thus, hey, clap when I mount bonk, jig up the lectern, bow to say it's all good. We gathered, withstood the bends of dives, deeper, darker, they clap as I get down. Sweat highlights my body. How meat's dyed, bloody, look fresher for showing. I got deep spit out my mouth, a rigid red rind, bloody melon, ha, no sweat. Joking, nobody knows the trouble. Rig full of deus, show, why fix this mess. Spit in tragedy's good eye. This one's called Jigger gogglers, then bow housefully. They clap, be misunderstood. Notes high or deep, make my tongue a bow. What's the gift, my good song vox? The gift, jiggle nickels from deep down my craw. They clap, ah, so jolly. Stood on that bank, body pit over bloody rattles. Braxton, sweaty brow syndrome. Spit out a sax bell, rig a negrocious show of feels. For show, sweat equals work, bloody ink pot of body. I stay nib dip, show, never run dry. Rigorously, I spit out stressed feet. Lines jig, ha, 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 ha. Good one that I is, bow deep, but not out, stood shining dim. They clap, waves slapping hulls. Deep don't mean sunken, goods not yummy, right? Bow. Blanched with foam, jig jigs. This one's called They Clap. Barrow, so much deep ends upon dead. Stood I on that bloody rise of sweet body. There you is too, sweat it lets. They clap, right? Some ass post spit to lipped. I said show. Okay, you're gonna need to do something lyrical. You're losing them, motherfucker, you're losing them. Don't choke. Do something lyrical. Okay, yeah. So this next poem is a lyric poem. It's called Every Day I Get. It's called Every Day I Get. There's a print. It's called Every Day I Gets. Every day I gets. I play the stone while old river tonguing me could fret me to grit. Not fret, but loves me up what they do on the regular. I'm a lover when I'm fighting peaceful here lately. When I cry, say, he's having river's babies. And so on the regular, I tend them. I tend to look mad as I find me more sand now, but nah, I'm fitful when I'm sleeping, wakeful a minute, my ears wet when I get up like drowning, though I've never, all my dreams Chevrolet heavy. This land would swallow me for one damn pearl. Thank you. This next one is called Black Flight. It just, you know, just occurs to me, like, you know, whether it's like, you know, like that, or like, like that. We think about Black Flight a lot, but we don't think about Black Flight as sort of like a Black middle class bougie abandonment of the hood for the burbs. You know, that's you know, that's usually reserved for white flight, but this poem is called Black Flight. And it's about living in the suburb of Maple Grove for a brief time in Minnesota. Came I was way out as it flies, but an easy green and skies, isn't it? My call to end is a nice, though it's like the knot I keep my knickers in, to, hey there, stay here. Damn right, I'd rather not squat some pissy asphalt plot, not rather put them up where I got to picket in self-defense. Not, no, but if so, then where'd I roost my hoodie among cooing polyphony? A no-go, a no-no, unless I'm turned me round. Awfuls everywhere I was. I couldn't see me there, only pinions. I've eyefuls of my absence everywhere. Here I go, hey there, I call now, and mo, and mo, and mo. Thank you. The applause is getting quiet. You're losing them. Do something emotional, but not like necessarily angry. Oh, sad, sad, sad. Do a sad poem. You're wearing a gray t-shirt and black pants. That's sad. These are sad. Do a sad poem. All right, yeah, but also make sure there's like something musical in it, because maybe then you can sing a little bit while it goes, and you know, you kind of got to put that in. Yes, all right, so this poem, I'm gonna leave my original script and do a poem just, you know, that just occurs to me to do right now, which is called Almost Gone. It's not on my original set list. Winking always confuses me because I need like there to be a mirror so I know that I'm like only telling myself that I'm lying, but you know, it's a stage. So I was not winking, I was squinting because of the bright light. Almost Gone, this poem makes reference to some songs, including the famous, sometimes I feel like a motherless child. The version I'm thinking about is the one by Odetta. It also names Nina Simone, and it names Zora Neale Hurston. There's gonna be mention of a type of tree called a deodar, and that is a tree that exists in the place I grew up in, which is Altadena, California. Almost gone. I wish I knew how not to know either my brother or I'll bury the other. Father, mother, dust variations, ill encore spun once more. Sometimes I feel like I'm not a simile. While motherless child's first verse unreels, child goes gone the second. An eagle in the air, I never hear Odetta do, just motherless, doubled. On to almost gone. Someone's recording something ever. Is her eagle down somewhere? A needle drops. Sometimes I feels bird and sky an antithesis to Nina's. This dialectical, this is taxidermy. One's mounting's freedom, other's dolor. A motherless child's a long way from home. Already, whether Odetta's Birmingham or our deodar needle, Dina, for freedom or never mind. Will to adorn, Zora goes, double descriptive. I go low down in plain pine. I'll go down, many versions, some dolorous moaning binds verses, motherless to almost, almost some sideways like. If my brothers all have me have him burned, almost gone. He would have me loose his ashes, almost deodar needles on Santa Rosa, near the old house, all the high tall cedars, though I'm a long way from home. Crows crowd the forfeit sky. All right, thank you. All right. So one of the things that people have been asking about with the book is the process of putting it together. And I'll get more into that during the Q&A. Maybe, you know, that's a question that somebody asks. But I wanted to kind of highlight one specific set of poems that went through a particular life cycle and then ended up in show. So the poet critic Fred Moten, who I mentioned earlier, has an essay called Black Cant, pronounced Cant, an update. In this, he had this thing that he called the list, a list for the natural history of inequality. There's the categories in the natural history of inequality. And so I decided I wanted to write poems for each of those categories. And the categories are the stupid, the irrational, the deformed and or deformative, the unfinished and or disruptive, the driven and or transportive, the irregular and or anti and anti-regulative, the blurred and or blurring, the curved, the canted, the arabesque, the paragon, the outwork and or mad absence of the work, the outlaw, the would have been outside, the thing of nature that defies or defers rather than presupposes representation, the social whose life in exhaustion of the given has often been mistaken for death. Now, I was gonna write, you know, a series of these, and a couple of things happened. One, I started writing them, and then I realized that what I was doing didn't feel like it was particularly rigorous enough. And so what I started doing then was I started going like, okay, there's 16 categories. If the first one is the stupid, then that will be the title, the stupid. The first line of the stupid would have to be irrational, because that's the second. The second line would have to be the deformed and or deformative. The third line would have to be the unfinished and or disruptive. And for every new poem, it would just simply move that structure up. So when we get to the poem, The Irrational, that's the title. The first line would have to be something deformed and or deformative, and so on. Now I thought, oh, this is gonna be dope, this is great. But apparently, the Pasadena Unified School District did not prepare me to count accurately. So I started writing several of these, and then I was like, oh shit, there's 16 and I'm only using like 14 of them. And so I started thinking, oh, well, you know what's really easy to do in a poem? Just add lines randomly into it to make it work. That's what you do. That's what you do, apparently. And so I didn't do that. And so between the kind of like writing some that were just sort of riffing on it, then starting to write some that failed to match the constraint, I just kind of said, all right, let me throw those out and I'll start just fresh. And so I started fresh and I wrote all of the series. Now, what had happened was when I was looking to put together show, I started digging back through old poems and found that some of those poems that had been started for this series didn't fit the series, but were perfectly good poems. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna read a few of the poems that are the working poems from that series. And those are gonna be published in a manuscript called I Imagine I've Been Science Fiction Always. And then I'm gonna read the ones that got into show after deciding to pretend to be other poems. So this poem is called The Irrational. So this is for The Irrational. I postulated breathing comes spitting into the saxophone will grow it lungs, but instead made me an aardvark cyborg, sucked up half a colony of notes from Bizet's Lalassin and picked up buku contronyms. On some spontaneous generation out that mess sprung reference junkies who referred me metonym, who referred me metonym for dark deeps, deeper darker than Thanatos, rocking a tux under a doctoral gown in a smoky jewel house down the bottoms, fixing to be renewed as experimental theater space. It already was already, years before yoga charcuterie and cold press designer breeds. My brass proboscis scrapes floors, thus sparks up a constellation. Though maybe it's the sax dragging me, meat shade. You find the notes where they're going, they haven't been. Let them stay doing what they do. Into a colony of reference, deeper, darker, experimental, already years before, you find they haven't been what they do. The needy needs something, doesn't they? E.g., my skin gets ringworm red. In our kitchen, I study scale proposal. If the notes I blow is big as colonists, figure I kaiju my cyborg ass. Crescendo myself past circular breathing's maximum occupancy. Even if that shit tear the stitches out my khakis, the housing crumbles around me, inhuman fossil from the future. I'm too winded to stop blowing now. Them fools still think they're tenors and wheeze vehicle. In show, the poem that was going to be The Irrational is called Promissory Note. And there's a reference there to MLK's speech where he says, and we were going to have a promissory note that was for just, I'm fucking that whole quote up, but he was like, "This gonna sign a check and it will be freedom, equality, and it'll bounce. But you know, and they don't let me cash checks at the store because my photograph is up in the wall." And it's yeah, so that didn't go anywhere, but promissory note. All right. 1,863 minus 1,526 equals billions. Remitted in paper to ransom us napped from families to captors. How much we want from each other, or is it for? Someone should pay for what someone shouldn't have paid for. Those doulos done to you know who done got past gum checks, bum backs, and lumped sum. Cuffy Coffle's chock-a-block with cast of Star Star of Night. Still, we called to see the bright side of whoever's newest mooning. Say, even if what bees lacked is not sense, isn't not a black fist, a handout made blunt? All right. I'm gonna do just a couple more because you know it's supposed to be 20 minutes, and so I don't want to go too far. But before I go, I just want. Oh my God. What are you doing, Doug? I'm doing a brand new dance. Oh my God, Doug. What is that dance called? It's called the Cruise Lineup Slow Grinder. What? I've never heard of that dance. Can you teach me how to do it? Yeah, sure, but I bet if you look deep back into your memory, you probably already know how. Oh my God, I cannot wait to learn it. Teach it to me. The cruise line up, slow grind up. Line up, everybody, for the rocking and rolling. You all in the groove from the windows to the walls. Hop that back, bend them knees, grind in tight on the one you're with it, down to the floor in this funky ass joint to dawn till dark. Fall next on the deck, cut your new cut. Y'all ain't never heard, but the man on the wheel will make you move. That hot body from coast to coast. Who got the most soul? Folk want to hear y'all holler. Follow these steps if you step. You best not too fast, not too far, not too low. Might catch the blues on the one and three. Damn it, don't lose the rhythm. Don't bring that beat back now. I'm a crew and I do best believe gonna see y'all work it. And thank you. And so for my final perms, I'm going to do, so I know there's like some transcribing. So I'm gonna skip the curved and I'm gonna skip static and I'm gonna go directly to the blurred and or blurring. Oh my gosh, y'all got like hymnals out there. I hadn't paid attention. Oh shit, I'm glad I was saying what's actually in the poems. Sometimes I'd be like, this poem is whack. I need to fix this here. Or like, kind of like slip in like a local place name and something to be kind of like, yeah, oh no, that's just what I was thinking. Really, baby, there's nobody but you. I wrote this for you. Yeah, I did. I wonder why you're looking at me like I'm lying. I ain't lying. Oh, come on, it's right there. Look, it's right here in the book, but I don't wanna, now you've cheapened it. You've hurt my feelings. Why don't you believe me? You never believe me when I tell you that I love you. You always think I'm lying to you, but I'm not. I love you so much. Sometimes I can just feel that love. It like gets inside of me and it's just like in there, just like deep inside of me. And it just wants to come out and it just wants to come out because I love you. So where are you going? Come back. Don't you dare go. No, I'm not trying to be. It's just that I love you. Please don't leave me because if you leave me, I don't know what I do. Oh my gosh. I didn't feel like I need to be with you because I mean every word I said. Yes, Ann Arbor. All right, this poem is called The Blurred and or Blurring. All right. Some Latinate Jurassic appellation would vest us against living this now in this here. Endangered species? Some appellation, species. Like that's not us down the root of their mutter, their fodder. Even so, on occasion, I catch me hard at humanizing ourselves, pathological redundancy, all man tantalus trying to link with the great chain of being. Tasked thusly in keen laborious failure, we appear both striker and scab. Resistance, montied with acquiescence all day, sucker, an egg laying a chicken. Eventually, insectile math chitters, they'll be us. How many systemic pleistocenes in teapots they brew to stunt their growth? Burn. Now see what wanting that chain gets you, you low-rating being here. The full moon expressed to monstrosities wanting their fat fetter blessed to be to bind. That's a person birthing up. If the thought the answer time machine, they ought to do their own damn remembering, dreaming for one damn once. At some sometime intervals, some now is bound to seem a then. So that was the blurred and or blurring. And That led to a poem in show called Fire, and this is what I'm gonna close with. And when I was trying to write Fire, what became Fire, and I was thinking about the blurred and the blurring, I was thinking about the distance between secular soul music and gospel music. Like, there's an old joke that says, if you wanna make a gospel song into a soul song, you simply replace the word Jesus with baby, right? So you can imagine somebody going, baby loves me this, but you know, get to that Bible part, which is kind of, you know, maybe that's weird. We might have to do something else there. But the idea is simple, one of substitution. But what that does is it also, important sense, that there might not be as much distance in Black cultures, particularly Black cultures, you know, that were responsible for generating soul music. And that goes all the way back to the continent, particular cultures in there, that there was not necessarily the separation between the flesh and the spirit. So let's fast forward to now. And something that I've observed in my time in many Black churches is that there is a liturgy, a set of songs that are sung. And oftentimes these songs have a deep, what you might consider an eros, right, in them. There's a song called There's Something About That Name. And what's fascinating is the songs sung in ways that you could also imagine secular soul or R&B songs sung oftentimes have a remarkable sort of queering effect, because you will get like a man who on another occasion would possibly, probably turn his nose up at homosexuality singing, Jesus, 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 there is something about that name. I mean, if that ain't baby, 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 there is something about that kiss. Like, that's Peebo. That's Marvin. Marvin. This poem is called Fire, and it features an orgy in a choir. Fire. God, we cry because nobody do us like the body. Oh, Jesus, love me. This I, no place low enough to keep me high enough, for when I feel filled with it, I am not ashamed to kneel. Not ashamed to sing when I have that name in my mouth. And oh, turned oh, and I turned ah, I am singing and turned what I owe to the blood what flowed. What we owe alive. That body by that spirit, what's flowing by the spirit isn't ghost, lest we ghost it. I from the row in the body of or up in it. My body up in my robe. My eye roll up to lift, to wonder from where I get what come. What's ghost isn't spirit. Spirit, what guy, sopranos, keen, pierce. It's licked, sweet glow, high enough, radiating, sweat before me. What rides high, the pierce they make to go inside us is, oh, in this place. Desk can't shake pearl rung. What runnels me, what runs so alto, shoulder rock. Nobody do us. Oh, Lord, oh, the treble throat on its dark ladder. What wrestle, come hither. Come higher, come lower. What wind rattle rock that don't rock, that don't roll? What's owed to the body of this, the body? What's shed? Come quiver, come quaver. Climb lower, oh, go down. Oh, do I? Chimes, enter, tenors, swayers. Sang now, get happy, they got it in them. Get it in me, filled with what oath? I know it was, I know it was, I know it was the blood. Bear down over it, a cleft bow low enough for the tremulous tremor, the things of the spirit in this place, the basis. We come, go down, not ashamed, I. To come, go down, oh deep black zenith, God, go down, lift up, take in what's licked, sweet body of the body of what's on high, oh, go down, oh, 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 that God, good spirit flow, pierce, run, suede, bode, what we owe the body, I see. We sang a sweet body of the sweet body we give. I know it was what flow in the row, in the body of the things of the spirit. I turn a rock, rock, trim a turn thing, nobody. I know it was, I know it was. My mouth full of sweat, what chime with what I know it was supposed to be, but shed like a skin, like a robe. Oh, I went down to the row in the sweet body of, I see. I hear what said was too ashamed to, oh, what flowed from the spirit. I know it wasn't what I see. Some said, like a snake, like a shame, what I owe, went down in the row. The word don't do me what I do now. Thank you all very much. I guess it's time for Quenda. Quenda. Quenda is a new beverage that's meant to quench the thirst for knowledge. Quenda, now coming in Pergo, track light, digital projector, all the flavors. I'm done. I'm just up here riffing, man. You can come on up. Like, I should. Oh, no, 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 no. I mean, no, but I appreciate that because I don't know what's going to happen either. But thank you so much for joining me up here,
thank
Chris.
Thank you.
And thank you all for being here.
Can everybody hear me well? All right, cool. Just taking a deep breath, and I feel like throughout hearing your poems and throughout talking to you today, I've just been saying thank you constantly and constantly, because that's all I can be. That's all I can really say. So thank you so much for sharing this space and your incredibleness with us.
Thank you so much, Chris. And I mean, you know, after working with you today, like really thinking about the, something we talked about a lot about Chris's work as he's moving through these, this idea of inheritance. I'm not going to tell him everything, right? Because I know you got,
you're good.
Like this idea of inheritance of violence, inheritance of a privileging of suffering and rejuvenation through blood and pain, and seeing that through the ultimate patriarchal figure, God, who then rhymes with Father, right? And what I feel like you're doing in your work is traveling through what we came to as a sort of a metaphysical space, a space that is not purely material, yet it certainly ain't nobody's afterlife. It's a present life in which we're grappling with being given things we might not want and not being able to make those things disappear, only being able to grapple and reckon with them. And that's something that's happening in the work that you're doing, the idea of materiality, incarnation, as a way of physicalizing a lineage, this abstraction of a past brought into a present body. I think one of the things that's remarkable about Christianity is a lot of times people are very comfortable with certain modes of the materiality of Christ, for example. You know, when he's suffering, that's fine. When he's being flogged, that's fine. But to think about him as having flesh and temptation is not allowed. And so that flesh becomes contingent based upon a set of values. I think that you're doing this work in such a way that reminds us of the materiality of what some might think of as just abstractions or different principles. So that's something I just wanted to say about your work.
Thank you for that. I feel like, yeah, that's just incredibly generous and thoughtful, and just giving me a lot of thoughts that I wouldn't have had unless you were here, obviously. So I want to talk about your reading, obviously, and about show, but I wanted to open up asking another question. So I was really moved by your interview on the Versus podcast with Franny Choi and Danette Smith. And in it, you talk about wishing something to someone that they haven't had. And I just thought that was so powerful. And I wanted to ask, what have you wished for yourself lately, or what wishes have you received and or been granted?
Wow. Well, I think I would be, you know, there's something about like poetry where in the world of poebiz, poets are often not supposed to, you know, talk about ambition, talk about like career or whatever. So, I mean, I will say, you know, just because it's number one, it's honest, and I think it's important for all y'all poets out there, like receiving a nod for a finalist as a finalist for the National Book Award is something that's really remarkable. Mm-hmm. Thank you. And I'm not gonna be up here and pretend that I'm not like feeling like, you know, about that. So I wanna say that first. You know, a wish I've received is, you know, my I have twins and they just started middle school, and you know, it's in person, and you know, so far they're healthy. So of course I was hoping for that, but I was also, you know, wishing that they could be in that environment and feel at least confident being in that space, right? And so that was something that I feel like has so far been true. You know, every day you kind of go, so, you know, you see them come out, you kind of go like, okay, nobody's limping, everybody's clothes are clean still, all right, how was the day? You know, so that's something. But I mean, something that I've wished for myself just really, you know, fundamentally is I find myself wishing for time. I feel as though, you know, I've tried to live as though I was getting 2 seconds for everybody's one, you know. And now I begin to feel more about like, like that will, that'll wear you down.
Yeah.
And so I find myself wishing for more time. Like, you know, it's maudlin, but again, wearing gray shirt, black pants. you know, like I love autumn. Like I love autumn. And you know, sometimes I'll be walking around in my neighborhood in St. Paul and I'll be like, man, I mean, I spent so long in a place where autumn didn't really make any kind of difference to the topography. And now I'm sort of like, I missed all of these autumns. And now I'm just trying to grab them up. So, you know, big surprise, the middle-aged poet is thinking about time. Mm. Somebody call somebody.
Yeah, it's really helpful to hear that perspective. And congratulations on your children feeling more comfortable and on the National Book Award nomination too. How does that feel, by the way, to get to that nomination?
It's awesome. It feels great. It's a bit fraught in the short list, in the long list. One of my dear friends, the incredible poet C.M. Burroughs, her book Master Suffering, which is fantastic book, please look at it, on the subject of bodies, right? Like I don't know if there's anybody writing about the body as a site of vulnerability and eros at the level that C.M. Burroughs is with just her second book. So please get Master Suffering. So that was, you know, like that was kind of fun. I was like, oh, this is great. But then, you know, goes to the next step and you're just sort of like, you know, and you know, she called me, so that was great. You know, she called me to congratulate me. I hadn't looked yet. I was like running at the track. Just keep myself from looking at my phone every minute. So that was great. I mean, it also, you know, there is a kind of an interesting, I don't want to say quandary, but something that was sort of a challenge when I was putting this book together is the fact that it's not using the kind of overtly performative typography that's become something that I've explored a lot. And I was nervous, honestly, about how that would be received. And you know, this kind of allowed me to put my money where my mouth is, because something I say a lot is that experimental, right, isn't an aesthetic. It's a process, right? You experiment. So somebody who's only done like, I don't know, algorithmic poetry for all their life, like building like poetry, like cognitive engines, who then decides, I'm going to write a traditional Elizabethan sonnet. That is an experiment for them, right? So for me, as I was putting this book together, it just got to a point where I did not feel like the performative typographic pieces would fit in it. And there's a bunch of like calculations in my head around that. So I just said, okay, well, let me just go without it. And I was talking to the poet, another brilliant poet, Latasha N. Nevada Diggs, whose first book, Twerk, came out, I think it was 2012 or 2013, and was just like, oh. But she said, oh, Doug, you're just showing your receipts. And I was like, okay. So it's funny because the next book is almost all like performative typography poems. Yeah, maybe it's like a correction, I don't know.
Yeah, I'll be interested to read the next one, and it's really interesting to see that shift between book studies and going to show. But I still feel like reading those books, there's, as you've displayed with your reading, this performative aspect going on. So I wanted to talk to you about your process of doing your readings, because Io brought up the essay, I Killed, I Died, that you wrote. Thank you for your wonderful introduction, Io. And in that essay, you talk about how a reading for you is showing when showing up for the poem isn't enough, how a poem can't really contain pain or other emotions that exist within the poem. So I was curious, have you always approached readings as you did today and others that I've seen, or what has led to that revelation for you to perform in this kind of way?
Oh, wow, oh, that's a great question. So in 2000, I wanna say 2008, my wife had a miscarriage, and I was thinking about writing about that. And I was thinking about, my impulse was to write a poem or some poems that would make the reader feel some kind of loss. But a couple of things occurred to me. Number one, that was, I felt like that was like horrible, like that's a horrible kind of violence to try to make somebody else experience. And so that, none of those worked, which was good. But then I also recognized the fact that to do such a thing would be to enter my family, you know, my wife, myself, our unborn daughter, into a kind of like a trauma contest, you know? So like, what's it look like? You know, I have a cousin who had like 3 or 4. I had a friend who literally risked blindness so you know, she could get pregnant. So I was like, that's not, like the move is not to be like, this is the, like everybody see this is the worst thing that has ever happened to any person. So I kind of laid back and cut on that. And then I figured out, like one day, I've been thinking about it for about 2.5 years. And I woke up one morning and realized that if I used a technique similar to the technique I use in a poem called Swim Chant for Nigger Merfolk, which reimagines the middle passage as this kind of jauntily twisted cartoon, that if I took this thing that was terrible and then treated it as though it like could be funny, right? That would magnify the terribleness of it. Mm. And that poetic strategy seemed to work. But what that made happen is, for the cycle of that book, which was called Patter. So basically from 2012 to about 2016, I was reading those poems. Writing poetry is not cathartic for me, in the sense if somebody thinks of release, like it's still like there. And so I found myself going to readings and really like teetering on this needle tip of my sense of the reading as a site of entertainment, and therefore I wanted to kill, right? Which is a comedic term for like really doing well. But while I was up there, I just felt like I was dying, a comedic term of failure, right? Because I was like, gotta do those miscarriage poems. Those joints is hot. Yeah, that's that fire. Like I gotta go up there and do those. And so like, you know, it's not the audience's fault. Nobody was sitting there like, you know, yelling out, do the miscarriage poem. You know, like that didn't happen, right? But I felt this thing. And so what began turning for me was my relationship to audiences, my relationship to this concept of cruelty. And that was building on something that the genius poet, I will say this every time I say their name, Lillian Yvonne Bertram, genius poet, who was here last year, like that, yeah, or very recently, Zoomed here, I guess, told me once when they heard an early draft of it, they walked up to me and they said, you are cruel to us. And in prepping for the lecture, I called them and asked them about that. And they said, no, when I said you were cruel to us, I also meant you too. You are cruel to yourself and us as an artist. So what that led to in this kind of response to performance was to stop thinking about the reading as a site where the reading of the poem was necessarily the attraction, right? Which is to say, you know, I feel like I'm a pretty good reader, but like, you know, like some people might not want to hear me like yell for like 15 minutes. There's something else, because most of the people in this room could read the book show, you know, on their own. Poetry is, I think, one of the only spectator events in the United States where, you know, you could have a member of the audience come up randomly and probably do the same job, right then. Because the job, you're not watching me write a poem, you're watching me read a poem that's already written. Like imagine that like a professional football game. Like if they were just like, and now you are the quarterback. Like that's like the kind of thing that only happens in like 80s movies. You know, imagine that at a ballet, right? Like, and now you jump in. But I've been to multiple readings where a member of the reading couldn't show up and they just ask a member of the audience to read one of the poems. And people go, oh my, yeah. That's a weird, like stop for just a second. That's weird shit. Like for real, it's kind of weird. And so it can't just be the reading of the poem. It then has to be like, what can I find out about the poet? And so for me, what began to become something that I thought a lot about was the space between the poems. How can, instead of me just saying, you know, and I did some of this tonight because I thought that might be interesting and I hadn't done this in a long time, but like instead of just saying, I wrote this poem because of blah, 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 boom, blah, boom, to try to recreate the space of the poet, of the poetic composition now in this room live in real time. And David Naiman commented that when I started, I was trying to make the page a stage, and now I'm trying to make the stage a page, right? And so that's become something interesting. I wanna tell you just a behind the scenes thing that was a very interesting experiment for me. For this reading, the request was that I provide the set list for it in advance to help with the captioning, right? Which I think is an extraordinarily necessary thing. But I never plan a week in advance what I'm gonna read. So there was something really fascinating about being in this sort of space and being like, well, I said I was gonna read these, they've typed these up, so I'm gonna read them. And not being able to respond in certain ways to what was happening in the room. Because if I then put all of the emphasis on what's happening between the banter, then that becomes, oh, I better do some weird shit, as opposed to doing what struck me. So I think there's something really interesting about that. And it's something that I haven't really had to deal with before. But I think that one thing that Zoom and the pandemic during Zoom has, Zoom during the pandemic has done is to make us much more aware of like how we can and should be providing accessible like readings all the time. So it just means that there's something else that I need now have to think about in terms of as a part of like the performance space and the performance itself.
Yeah. I really like how you're sharing that. And I think the thing that's sticking out to me about both the banner and reciting your poems is the amount of like attention, like you grab our attention with everything that you're doing. And I was like really curious because in show there's moments like where you're like inviting us in or using direction, being like, look, or hey, Fox, or
right,
no,
right.
No. Oh, so yeah. I'm wondering, how do you hope readers notice or learn from your words? And is there a difference when encountering it on the page? I guess you've already talked about it on the stage, but I'm just wondering about how you want readers to engage in both venues.
That's a good question. One of the things that I think about in terms of encountering it on the page is I feel like we have forgotten that the book is a technology and the book is the first DVR, right? DVRs are trying to be books because you can stop, you can go backwards, you can skip ahead, you can do all those things. And we go like, oh my God, I can do this with the movie. Oh my God, this is the most incredible shit ever. And the book is like going, yeah, that's great. You know, like, like who knew you could like stop time and come back when you're done doing that thing? Who knew you could read that? You could go back to something you were interested in and stay there for a while and keep rewinding it. Wow. Thank God somebody made the DV motherfucking home, right? And so like, to me, there's something that happens when a reader is holding the book without making any kind of breach of convention. A reader holding a book controls time. Hmm. Like you control, like if something's very dense or really beautiful, you can slow down and you can pick your way through. You can go back, start it over. Go, wait, what? Now, what was that? Whereas in a reading, if everyone is behaving, right? And this is important, if everybody's behaving, you are subject to my time. Like it was exciting for me when I saw y'all had the papers for it because like, oh, great. Like, oh, cool. You know, like maybe there's something that just from the particularities of this reading, I might fumble or speed through too quickly or something like that. But even that's different than when you're at home or on the bus or, you know, at the coffee shop reading on your own. Right? There are things in the poem that I do not expect. And this is not to sound condescending. I'm using like tons of puns like all the time. It would be ridiculous for me to go like, yeah, you caught all three meanings, right? When I read that a minute ago and I was flopping around, yeah, you caught all three. Nah. But there's sound, which is there whether I'm reading it or not, right? Because I'm using the pronunciation of these words, I'm using prosody, you know, might keep you in there. And make you kind of feel like, well, there's something I want to stay in this place. So I think that readers control time with the book. Now, why it's important to say that when we're all behaving is that in other ways, you are only subject to my time by the conventions of US American poetry reading inside an academic institution. I have been to a reading. Once I was in a reading that lasted an hour and a half of just me reading. I brought this binder and I just read everything I'd fucking written. I think there was a Christmas list from when I was 7 in there. I don't even know. But like I read, and after about an hour of reading, it was in the supper club in Milwaukee. And it was like all my uncles and aunts, it looked like all my uncles and aunts were like in a circle around me with chafing dishes behind them as I sat and read this. And they're like, okay, there was one that went kind of like, yeah, could you do that again, but do it slow. Hmm. Right? I was at one reading back in San Diego very early in my work and I was reading something, blah, 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 whatever. And somebody got up and says, parasites, and stormed off the room, stopped the reading, right? Stopped the reading. He took control of the time. The only reason I'm in control of time is that people by the conventions go like, I shouldn't get up and say, ah, slow down. Like, I shouldn't do that. So I'm not gonna. But that's contingent, right? Now, if I show up and I say, I'm gonna read my poems, I open a book and I stare at you for 20 minutes on some John Cage shit, right? Like that's not poeming, right? So I think there's this really interesting exchange and interplay between who powers time during the live reading. But for me, you know, what I want to be able to deliver during a time, a live reading, is I want there to be a reason besides maybe having to for class or whatever to have come and been there, been here. And so for me, I want that to be as a collective group of people. I mean, you know, there's lots of stuff happening right now. Like there was a time where I started moving closer. I was like, oh shit, I can't get within 12 feet. Like there's just lots of things that we're negotiating now. And what that simply means is welcome to the present. So now deal with the present. Deal with being here now and what this means. So yeah, I think about it like that. Ideally, I mean, I think whenever you read anybody's poetry, unless it is impossible to do so, I think you should read it aloud. Like anybody's poetry. Like there is a visual aspect to it, of course, but I think you need to hear it a lot of times, or even maybe it's just sounding it. What happens when you have a stanza with no line breaks and no punctuation and it goes on six lines? Like, that's about breath, right? So if you're just kind of, that's like going to a film and doing this. And not having subtitles and not having any of those things. So like, I hope people read poems aloud. And I at least try to make this sort of pleasurable mouthfeel, the milk tongue that Donald Hall talks about, be something that organizes a lot of my poems to encourage that.
Wow, I have so many directions I want to go, and I want to ask one question before we open up to audience. I have so many more, but this is just I'm learning a lot from you. And that was something I did when reading show. I usually have been reading poems just in my head. And I was like, wait, what am I doing? I need to read these aloud.
Right?
And so I did that. I was like, whoa, I'm noticing so much more. And what I've been noticing as I read it out loud is, like, you've talked about, I think it's like drum kit prosody.
Yeah.
Like drum the syllabics prosody that you've used in your work. And I was wondering, like, how do you come up with, like, the first line that Io was talking about? Seems some want somebody bodied in the street, sweet meat. That's hard for me to say right now. Like,
right.
How do you come up with stuff? Like, is that just innate, or do you have like tricks or tools that you use to engineer or use the drum kit to come up with lines like that?
Yeah. Thank you for that. Right? I mean, some of it has to do with being in my early 20s during the speed rap era, you know? So like when on a Deep Cover Twins remix, Big Pun goes, dead in the middle of little did we know that we riddled some middlemen who didn't do diddly. Like that as just, that's like, I won't say pop music in the sense of like how we think of like, you know, Doja Cat or whatever, but like you didn't have to dig hard if you were a hip hop fan to hear that song. That was just like, that's just a hip hop song. And there was just this section that he knew was gonna be some shit that people were gonna be like, oh, but that collection of sounds, right? Like listening to people put, you know, phrase Tyler Quali, call us liberty like the Bella Philadelphia scenery, me and Bahama D style, feel like Mumia need to be seeing me, feeling me. We right here on the level, turning hard rocks to pebbles, exposing the devil, lyrical Olympian like John Carlos winning gold medal. Take that bass out your voice, you talk to me in treble, right? Like these doublings, right? When I'm thinking about drum machine prosody, if I were to think about it in connection to, like, say, what we understand as an aspect of Greek meter, there's slow spondee, the double stress, like, you know, cat, hat, like both of those stress. For me, what then becomes next is a third stressed, a fourth stressed, a fifth stressed. How do I keep as many beat, 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 beat? In the same way that if I had a drum machine, I could interrupt the pattern and just hit that snare button, and they'd all be the same volume, right? There wouldn't even be the muscle memory, like, recovering for the and variations there. And so what there's a writer named Lewis Turco who talks about in English, in the English language, in most poems, the moment you have more than two stressed syllables in a row, you will demote one of those syllables to a slightly less stressed. So it kind of flows with the way we're used to hearing English, right? The commas in a list create enough of a pause that, you know, that stress kind of leaves the sense of there's like a release. But my interest is in, like, what if I try to compose in such a way that you can't tell which should get demoted? What happens in a sentence that insists upon a several stressed things in a row without it necessarily being a list? Well, in the English language, those are verbs. In the English language, those are nouns. In the English language, some of those are adjectives. So now I'm creating a sentence. Use the big college words, an epistemology in which several nouns can exist in a sequence without being a list. They're not being itemized. Own sort of individual space. Or what happens if I have several verbs? Then that means that there's multiple actions happening. But again, it's not a list. There's a kind of question around simultaneity in there. Mm. And so for me, I look for words that that repeat without being redundant. Mm. So my thought is, like, how can I repeat without being redundant? And I appreciate your question about, like, how did I get to that? I got to that doing an approach to poetic composition that I call word banking. I know there's a learning exercise, but I was thinking of something different. And what it would be like is basically if I came up with a line or two that maybe had 14 words in them, I tried to see if I could compose entire poems using just variations of the sequencing of those words. And so for a long time, like, if I were writing a poem or an essay, I was using word banking. So there'd be this kind of, like, a really dense set of significations. And then every time you kind of give yourself a new word to add to that, it's kind of like, but then it's like, but now I have to juggle that one. And so doing that exercise, poems came of that. The poem Big Thicket in Buck Studies is an early example of that. Doing that kind of exercise taught me to hear what happens when you put the word, same word, identical word next to itself. What happens? So somebody bodied, right, takes on body, this, and then the slang term of killed, bodied. Somebody got bodied. On streets, on some sweet street meat, some to that some, all that bouncing back and forth. And so I'm deeply interested in sound and building chime and recognition, because if all of this other swirl is happening, the chime gives the reader something, but okay, boom, okay, I got that sounding, okay, boom, right? Like, we're searching for patterns. We're searching for any kind of toehold. And so the sonic place is where I oftentimes will make sure there's a toehold or try to put a toehold. By the same token, of course, pun teams meaning, T-E-E-T-E-E-M-S, teams meaning. This means this and that and this and that. So what happens when the entire wall is toehold? Well, how can you climb this and pattern? Wow.
Seeing poetry in a whole new way. This is amazing. I want to open up for audience questions if Folks have some. There's microphones on either side of the stage if you're feeling inclined. Or are there some on Zoom too?
Oh, cool. Zoom questions.
Hello. I'm representing our many Zoom people who are tuning in.
Cool. Hello,
and
Zoom.
I've got a question from Jillian, who teaches poetry and thinks about poetry here in the English department. Mm-hmm. And Jillian asks, what do the exaggerated, performed, generic gestures to lyric and your refusal of it have to do with the text you wrote and show? Are your poems responses to an idea slash constraint called lyric?
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, oh, that's such a good question. All right, so one of the things that began exciting me about the idea of show was something sort of self-deprecating, which is like, I'm going to write nice poems that can be typed up. Like, these are poems, you know, just perms. But something I'm interested in from the more sort of performative typography poems is this idea of simultaneity, right? Like, what happens when we read most texts is, you know, you can do interruption. I was talking and wait a second, like if you're looking down this line that begins to kind of like stand in for time, right? As we read, we're going across and we got that. So a lot of the kind of performative typography pieces are about what happens when two words are said at the same time. How do we understand that? And to use the phrase about promotion and demotion, which takes the lead, right? Which takes the lead. So when I decided that I wasn't gonna do any of those things, it made me think that the simultaneity in the way that I'm used to making it happen was going to be, I wasn't going to be able to do that. I was going to have to figure out some other technique. And I didn't want to have sort of like a paratextual aspects of it that sort of say, that would be like in italics, like you might read a play, read simultaneously. Like, I didn't want to do that. So what I began doing was I began thinking about how the collaged texts, the texts that the poems that have multiple voices, something that's important about them is that very multiplicity, the idea of chorus, the idea of clamor, the idea of many people. When you get them in close proximity to other phrases, what you get are things that are sentences by proximity, not necessarily sentences by syntax, right? If you have a phrase that's here, it kind of cuts off, and it butts up against a phrase that's here that kind of cuts off, right? There's a tendency to want to link those. But what happens is you end up with this kind of English syntax that sounds like it's not quite fluent or fluid, right? So I began noticing that in these performative typography pieces. And what that then led to was this idea that there should be a difference, something that people call broken English, right? Is usually assigned to people who are supposed to be uneducated. I began to think, what if it's not broken English? What if it's double jointed English? What if to use a double negative is not a lack of facility with the fact that you only need one, but is actually simultaneously an amplification of the negative, of the lack, at the same time that it offers the grammatic negation of lack. So if I say, I ain't got no money, it might not be because I don't understand, you know, I don't have any money. It might be, I really, really don't have any money. At the same time though, the idea of negation and sort of canceling out becomes something that I think of, you know, there's lots of different ways to kind of think about it, but I think you'd have to think about it dramaturgically. What is the context in this poem of that double negative, right? So anyway, I'm not doing this with my poems in this book. So what that pushed me to do then was to write freehand, like I just compose double jointed sentences. This is one of the ways that my that I think about the syntax that is possible in these poems. So I'll just give a quick example, make it less abstract. In the poem Black Flight. There's a line that goes, a sentence that goes, damn right, I'd rather not squat some pissy asphalt plot nine. Rather put them up where I got to picket in self-defense, right? Like, it starts off, rather put them up, starts as a statement, but then it turns into a question after the enjambment. And I want it to have that same sort of flexibility. So now how that all ties into lyric. If I'm not having the sort of ocular multiplicity of a number of different typefaces or blocks of text sort of scattered around a text, then if I move that into the syntax of an individual sentence, then I'm trying to create multiplicity in what might appear to be an I statement. And so that multiplicity is sometimes a subjectivity, sometimes it's an opinion being expressed, that suddenly the opinion is both and, you know, or as Andre 3000 says, oh, hell no, but yet it's that too. Like, sometimes it's that kind of multiplicity. And so I think that there's this kind of constant shuttling around of the I. There's a constant externalization, right, of the private, which is something that's you know, a typical aspect of the lyric. But what happens when, you know, what happens when your whole skin is your mouth? What is interiority for people who are considered to lack a consciousness? So I find myself exacerbating that sense of resisting the idea of here's just a single I, even when there's no visual cues to that. And also rethinking what it means to make external that which has been the most common interactivity with people from, you know, the cultures that are kind of constellate the culture that I'm from, right? Like, you're always externalizing. So the need for a category called lyric is not necessarily ontologically connected to my experience. And so while I'm not programmatic about these things. Like, I'm not trying to like walk around and be like, hey, brother or sister or fam, how come you be using I? Like, I'm not interested in doing that. But I find that intentionality towards pressing against lyric leads me to create poems that I would not create if I were not grappling with that question. That was a very long answer. Thank you for coming up.
I was looking to, well, first of all, to say,
yes. Yes.
And I had just like the final poem question comes to me. I don't forget the name of the poem, Douglas Kearney Connection, from Douglas Kearney.
Oh, it's all right.
I was working with Tori Greyhouse over the summer. I only mentioned it because.
Absolutely.
About how to write a memory risks collapsing the subjectivity and reality of its truth. And in that poem, Nasology, you write about recalling a memory, but in a way where it is prompted from a request to write. Towards a white liberal audience. Mm-hmm. And that seems to be a kind of thread that moves throughout the book. I was wondering if you could speak to that idea of performance. You spoke so much about it in terms of your actual performance, but mm-hmm. the idea of performance, like Shakespeare said, all over the stage, mm-hmm. As it moves through the book, how it relates to that, the memory as you move between different events throughout the book as well.
Thank you. Wow, that's a fantastic question. And yes, I am proud of the fact that Torin's there. She's like, you know, it's going to sound like I say every poet I meet, I'm just like, oh yes, there. but I've been lucky. I've met many brilliant poets. So if I think about sort of memory and being called to remember, right? Something that I feel happens in that moment is you are being asked to remember something as a kind of plastic object. So you could take it and you could turn it in all of these different kinds of ways. But you're also being asked to take that plastic object and shape it in such a way that it will become legible, resonant for someone else. Now the thing that's interesting about this is, although that poem and many of the poems in the book, you know, think about that in the kind of extractive way of like, you know, frequently Black people under, you know, a white gaze, one could make the argument that anytime somebody asks you, you know, your closest lover who is not anti you any kind of way, right, you're trying to make something clear and possessible, legible, apprehensible, right? but also apprehendable, so that it can be experienced and held, mm-hmm. right? I feel like a poet, you know, like Fred Moten, who, you know, apparently doesn't need me to call him a genius, because, you know, MacArthur did. and many of us who've encountered him go like, okay, yeah. There's a way in his poems where I feel like I will read one of his poems, and if somebody asks me, all right, what did you like about it? It slips. It, you know, there's the fugitivity. So I feel like Moten has figured out a way to use what we might call, after Stephen Henderson, mascons, mass concentrations, like these kind of charged cultural ideas and images, and to present them in such a way that then, along with the rhetorical movements of the poem, it makes them kind of, you know, slip through your fingers, like you're trying to grab a small thing that's half submerged in a bucket of water. Right? Just kind of escapes your hands. For me to think about that as performance, right, on one level. So I'll start with the stage, although I know that's not where we need to end up. If I think about that as performance, I would think about that as being something like what I describe in Messan as a shimmy, right? The movement of a shimmy is, you know, you push the hip out and then you move it back away. This is the thing you want. Here it is, up, and now it's gone. Want it? It's gone. Want it? Gone. Want it? Gone. Want it? Gone. Want it? Gone. Right? And so I feel like Moten, in a work like B. Jenkins, is doing these shimmies where it's like, here it is, up. And it's all up to you, you know, how far you want to try to go to grab it. Now, what this does, and when I think about performance as a kind of a social, a way of being in a sociality, or a way, perhaps better yet, a way of trying to transform the social into a sociality, right? The social is us out in a public. The sociality is a group that is entered in sort of mutual preservation, right? So manners in any culture are designed to create connection with the social. It's designed to make you appear to be a valued member of what could then be a sociality. And a sociality allows interdependence and cooperation and mutual aid, right? But I am aware or at least I should say, but I have been taught, and I haven't seen lots to tell me that retaining this lesson is more dangerous than not having this lesson. I haven't seen, my life has not allowed me to think that retaining this lesson is more dangerous than not. That the possibility of being a Black person in the social is to, by definition, create through the white gaze an anti-sociality, that which should not be countenanced, that which cannot be a part of mutual aid, that which cannot be involved in those cycles. And this is to say, as I said, and I want to be very deliberate about what I said, I have not experienced the world in such a way that tells me forgetting, like retaining that sense of the world is more dangerous than forgetting it. Which doesn't mean tonight when we're standing around talking to each other that I'm be sitting there going like, none of them accept me. No, instead it's saying the possibility of my being expelled from a sociality in a social construct of anti-Blackness means that it doesn't actually matter how I behave. I don't have to do anything to be expelled except be present. And if I'm not the one present, someone who looks roughly like me will do. And so this work in thinking about performance, on the one hand, I think about it as a kind of training and preparation, a discipline with all senses of, you know, discipline, which also suggests like what? Punishment, discipline, being disciplined. But one of the things I'm trying to learn to do through the stage performance is to find through a different performance, through a different script, what is the space I can build in any context, whether, you know, whatever the context is, what is the space I can build in a context that allows me to be present in a way that feels good and not necessarily transactional. And though this is a very mediated space, like, you know, you all came, my face is on a poster, like I'm somebody y'all supposed to like listen to, even if I'm rambling, y'all supposed to like, well, no, this is, he knows something. Like, this is very mediated, but doing this now bleeds into my civilian life. And that it's a practice, it's another discipline, it is a practice. It's a practice. Yet even with that, I don't find myself telling my children, oh, this is what you do to exist. Because again, I have not experienced that it is more dangerous to retain that understanding than it is to lose it. Thank you very much. Thank you for your question. Thank you.
Yeah, I have the same sentiment. I wish you talked about the DVR earlier. I wish we had time to like
pause and
bask in all the greatness that you have to share with us. So thank you so much for this gift and sharing space with me and just giving us this awesome reading and talk. So thank you. I'm going to turn over to Michaela.
I'll spend.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just want to echo Chris's thanks and truly calling it a gift to be in this room tonight as a collective, as you said, Douglas. Thank you so much for your performance. Thank you, Chris, for facilitating the Q&A, and thank you, Io, for a beautiful introduction. I just want to also offer a reminder that Douglas will be giving a craft lecture tomorrow morning as well from, I'm sorry, a workshop, not a lecture, from 10 to 11:30. You can join either via Zoom at the same link that you used tonight, or you can join us in person in Angel Hall 3154 tomorrow morning. And you can also sign up for our email list, either using the sign up sheet that's right outside the door of the auditorium or following a link that will be dropped in the chat. And my last announcement is to please buy Douglas' books from Literati. I know that many copies of Show have arrived. That's our local bookstore. And thank you for joining us, and enjoy the rest of your evening.